Good afternoon. My name is Devon Glass. I'm a partner at Seacrest Wardle, and I'm here to discuss navigating uninsured and underinsured motorist claims. This is a general overview of the topics we're going to be covering today. These are the big headline issues. The first is, what is an uninsured or underinsured vehicle? The next is how to know, figuring out what is a vehicle, whether it's uninsured or underinsured. Determining who is entitled to collect benefits for an uninsured or underinsured claim. Any defenses to coverage that may be available. Whether there's a compensable injury and things to consider when resolving an uninsured or underinsured motorist claim. I'm also going to be discussing very briefly an issue that's come up lately, which is the deposition of uninsured or underinsured claim adjusters. It's not on this sheet. It's a new one that has just become a pertinent issue, and I'll address that at the end. First and foremost, when we're looking at an uninsured claim, what is an uninsured vehicle? An uninsured vehicle is a vehicle that does not have the security as required by MCL 500.3101. The statute in Michigan requires that all vehicles have some sort of security on the vehicle in the event of a motor vehicle accident. Out-of-state vehicles will be considered to have be insured or have insurance if they meet their own state requirements. So if a vehicle from Florida is involved in an accident in Michigan and they have a minimum policy that is different than Michigan statute requires, say it's a $10,000 BI coverage and Michigan has a $20,000 minimum, if they meet their state's definition of insured vehicle, then they will be considered insured and meeting the security requirement under 500.3101. The owner or a constructive owner, and I'll get into the definition of a constructive owner in a minute, the owner is required to carry the insurance on any vehicle that they own. A constructive owner would be someone who has use of the vehicle, access to it, does not need permission to use it, might have their own keys, for more than 30 days. So if some person owns a vehicle and they have a significant other who they let use the vehicle or they share the vehicle with for more than 30 days, they don't have to ask permission to use it. They have access to it whenever they desire. They have a set of their own keys. If they have access to it for more than 30 days in a calendar year, they would be considered a constructive owner. Now, obviously, there are a number of different nuances to all of that, but that's a general principle under which a constructive owner would be defined. An uninsured vehicle could be a hit-and-run accident. So if somebody is alleging that their vehicle was either contacted or pushed off the road or somehow forced into a situation that was involved an accident and that vehicle, this other vehicle, fled the scene of the accident and there's no information and that person is not found, then that would be considered a hit and run and would be considered an uninsured vehicle under most policies. Typically, most insurance policies require contact with the vehicle in order to make this claim. Some do and some don't. So that's just going to be policy specific. If a vehicle does not have insurance and the driver of the vehicle does not have insurance, it could be considered uninsured. So if I'm driving a vehicle that is owned by my wife or my friend, something like that, and I don't have insurance, and the owner of the vehicle also doesn't have insurance, and there's no other constructive owner, then that vehicle would most likely be considered to be uninsured. However, each policy is going to be different, and you're just going to have to check the policy language to make sure that the vehicle meets that definition. An underinsured vehicle is a little bit easier to determine. It states in the slide here, a vehicle that has the security, so some sort of underlying coverage. In the example here, there's a minimum policy of $20,000, and your insured may have purchased a coverage for uninsured or underinsured benefits that would be in excess of the underlying coverage. So if there's a $20,000 underlying policy, your insured has purchased $50,000 in underinsured motorist coverage, they could potentially recover $20,000 from the tortfeasor, and then an additional $30,000 from the underinsured carrier, which would be their own insurance company, for a total of $50,000. The underinsured policy would not be an additional $50,000. It's up to the maximum when you total up every potential underlying policy to determine the full value. So if they had $20,000 and $100,000, that would be a potential of $80,000. If there are two policies, if there's two $20,000 policies underlying the underinsured claim, then that would be $40,000 from the tortfeasor in this other policy, and then an additional $60,000 from the underinsured coverage. There are a few different ways to determine if a vehicle is uninsured. So you want to first look to see who the owners of the vehicle are. If there are more than one owner, then you want to run a search to see if that person has insurance with any policy from any carrier. Typically speaking, there may be a certificate of insurance in the vehicle that is listed on the UD-10 report. If that's not listed on the UD-10 report that there is insurance, sometimes it'll say no insurance, and that's the first indication there might not be insurance coverage available. Then you just need to investigate, you know, who was driving the vehicle, who owned the vehicle, who may be a constructive owner. Some vehicles may be owned by more than one person. Some vehicles may be owned by a business. There are a variety of different circumstances that would involve multiple owners or multiple policies that could provide coverage to make it clear whether it is an uninsured vehicle or an underinsured vehicle. So you want to look at the police report, run a title search, take an EUO of the driver or the owner to see if there's any potential coverage that might be available. Do a carrier search. Those are all different avenues to determine this. Now, of course, if the owner of the vehicle is not insured, the driver may have their own policy separate from the owner of the vehicle, and in that case, that vehicle would not be uninsured. It may be underinsured in any of these circumstances, but the driver having a policy, even if the owner of the vehicle does not, would not create a circumstance where it was an uninsured vehicle. An underinsured vehicle, you're going to conduct most of the same searches to determine if there is underlying coverage. You want to take a look at the policy of the owner or constructive owners. You want to take a look at the policy for the driver of the vehicle to determine if there is any coverage for any of these individuals. You want to look at the policies and the declaration pages to determine whether the underlying policies would stack up or whether they are considered to be separate. Each policy will be different, but you want to obtain the declaration page and the policy for each coverage that may be underlying your underinsured policy. So if we have a circumstance in which there is $100,000 of underlying coverage and your insured has purchased $100,000 of underinsured coverage, there would be no potential recovery for an underinsured claim because the underlying policy limits meet the policy limits for the underinsured claim. Also, if there's a $250,000 policy on the tortfeasor and there's a $100,000 underinsured benefit for your insured, again, there would not be any underinsured coverage available because the underlying coverage for the tortfeasor exceeds the coverage of the underinsured policy. Who is entitled to these benefits? They are contractual in nature and they go to the individual or individuals identified on the declaration page and who owns that policy. There is no statutory guidance on how these claims are to be carried out. Each claim for uninsured and underinsured benefits is dependent on the policy language of the particular uninsured or underinsured claim. If it's a Progressive policy, it's going to be handled different than an auto owner's policy, and so on. Person who is seeking coverage, so if there's an injured individual you're insured in most circumstances or every circumstance, they're going to look to their own policy. So if they are a Progressive insured, they're going to look at their declaration page to see if they have this coverage. They're going to see if they have that coverage, and if it's available, you'll have to investigate to see whether or not they're entitled to that benefit, depending on what the underlying coverage is or if there is no insurance available. The named insured is always going to be covered under the policy. Resident relatives and family members may be entitled to coverage depending on the policy language. Again, that's very policy specific. Everything is going to be based on the specific language of your policy, and sometimes those policy details change when new policies are issued. So you're going to want to make sure to look at the specific policy that was in effect at the time of the incident. Again, as I mentioned before, most contracts require evidence of contact between the vehicles in an alleged hit and run situation. So if someone is claiming a hit and run, there's going to have to be some sort of evidence that there was a contact point between your insured's vehicle and this alleged hit and run vehicle. If this vehicle that ran, if there's a situation in which your insured's vehicle was forced off the road with no contact, depending on the policy language, it may not be a covered event. But you'd have to be very careful about your investigation. You want to take a look at the vehicle itself. You want to get photographs, see what kind of investigation was performed. You'll look for paint potentially from another vehicle on that. You'll look for scrape marks, other things that would be evidence of an actual contact between the two vehicles. If you do not see evidence of a contact and the contract requires evidence of a contact, then you may have a defense to coverage, which is the next topic here. So if there is no contact and the policy requires contact, then you have a defense to coverage. Another issue is underlying coverage meets or exceeds the extent of the injury. So as I mentioned earlier, if there's a $100,000 policy for the tortfeasor, there's a $100,000 underinsured benefit that may be available. There is no coverage because the underlying policy meets the coverage of the underinsured policy. If the injury does not meet the threshold, so if we're looking at whether the individual has a serious impairment of a body function that affects their ability to lead their normal life, you'll have to evaluate whether or not they meet that criteria. If there's a permanent serious disfigurement, and whether or not that would be compensable, or if the individual has passed away. Those would be elements that you would want to examine to see whether or not they've met the threshold under MCL 500.3135. Most, if not all, underinsured policies require that the underlying coverage tender their policy limits before any consideration of the underinsured benefit will be afforded. If there is no tendering of the full policy limits of the underlying policy, then the underinsured benefit will not have been triggered. There also may be an instance where there is a step-down provision. So if the individual who has been determined to be at fault or is alleged to be at fault is a family member and the underinsured claim is being processed, So let's say there's a husband and wife. If the wife is determined to be at fault and the husband is injured, if there's an underinsured claim that might be available because the wife is insured with another insurance carrier than the husband, then the underinsured limits may step down to the statutory minimum requirements. So even if they have a $500,000 underinsured claim or policy that might be available, if it's against a family member or some other category of individual, it may cause that limit to be reduced to the statutory minimum. Many of these policies have notice requirements or limitations periods in which the insured is required to notify the insurer of an intent to pursue a claim for uninsured or underinsured benefits. If an individual does not notify the insurance company of the potential for a claim that may limit or eliminate the insured's ability to collect under the uninsured or underinsured policy. However, that again is policy specific, and you'll have to just take a look at the policy language itself before you make a decision about whether or not they have met their notice requirement. When we look at a compensable injury, we look at the statute 500.3135. I kind of went over these things, but generally there has to be an objectively manifested impairment of an important body function that affects their ability to lead his or her normal life. So an objectively manifested injury is something like a broken bone or even something like a degenerative change on an x-ray or an MRI, anything that can be visualized in some sort of manner, whether it be an imaging study, blood work, actual observation of the individual. So if they're walking and it's clear that there's some sort of impairment, that could be evidence of an objective manifestation. Obviously, the stronger the evidence, such as an imaging study or a diagnosis from a physician, would be the most strongest level of evidence, but you'll just have to evaluate that. An important body function. Generally speaking, if somebody breaks their arm, courts have held that the use of someone's arm is an important body function. Again, if somebody hurts their neck or their back, these are considered to be important body functions. If somebody hurts their pinky finger, and it's not really impacting, the pinky finger isn't that involved, but if it's a broken bone, might not be an important body function, but it's still a broken bone and it's going to impact how they use their hand. And then finally, it affects their ability to lead his or her normal life. So if they broke their pinky and they're still able to do their job and go to work and take care of their family and other obligations, then there wouldn't be said to have an impact on their normal daily life. But again, it's that person's normal daily life. So you'd have to take a look at that person's lifestyle before the accident. What activities did they engage in? What social endeavors did they pursue? Were they working? Did they work from home? Did they exercise? Did they participate in sports? And if those things that comprise their normal daily life have been impacted, then it becomes a question of fact, after looking at all of these different categories, of whether or not there has been a threshold injury. It doesn't mean that a motion for summary disposition couldn't be filed. It's just that if a person has a broken arm and they use their arm regularly and it prevented them from doing their normal life for 3 to 6 months, there's a potential for a recovery. A judge may not dismiss a claim like that. It just depends on the facts and the proofs. The underinsured claim won't be triggered until all of the underlying policies have been tendered. So if there are a policy for the driver, and there is a policy for the owner, and there's also the underinsured policy after that, both underlying policies in that circumstance would need to tender their policy limits before the underinsured policy would be available to your insured. When looking at resolving a claim of an uninsured or underinsured motorist, you want to take a look and see if their injury meets the threshold that we've described. If they broke their pinky and there's really not much else that's impacting their normal life, they may not meet or exceed the underlying coverage for a $20,000 policy. However, if they fractured their neck, if they've broken their leg, they're paralyzed, something like that, it is more likely that that person would meet, at the very least, the underlying policy or exceed it. And obviously, it depends on the policy limits of the underlying claim for an underinsured benefit. So if there's only $20,000 of coverage and somebody fractured both legs, it's most likely that they are going to exceed the underlying coverage and you may have exposure on the underinsured claim. For uninsured benefits, that's really not an issue in terms of the underlying coverage because there is no underlying coverage. So there wouldn't be a requirement to determine the severity of the injury before the policy takes effect for an uninsured claim. It really only comes into play for an underinsured claim. If there's a $500,000 underinsured policy, but there's $250,000 of coverage before it, there would need to be a very significant and severe injury that would put you in a category of coverage that might breach the underlying limits. However, if that person has died, then that generally would get close to and almost always exceed those underlying policy limits. The most important thing in performing a resolution on an underinsured claim is obtaining a waiver of subrogation. And that's the insurance company's right to file a claim against the tortfeasor to collect their coverage, the money that they've spent. And when resolving an underinsured claim, there's always going to be an issue of waiver of subrogation. So generally speaking, for an underinsured claim, there is a right to recover damage or collect money from the tortfeasor who is responsible, and the underlying tortfeasor will want a waiver of subrogation so that nobody's going to come against them to collect the money that was paid out due to their liability or fault for this accident. So there's always going to be an issue of negotiating a waiver of subrogation for the tortfeasor. Unless that individual has assets that would allow for a recovery. So if this person is a wealthy individual and they have a lot of liquid assets, there might be a potential for subrogation under that situation, and then the waiver of subrogation could become a negotiating point in resolving the claim. So you'll want to do an asset check on the underlying tortfeasor to see if there is any liquid assets, if they own any businesses, if they have any other insurance policies, if they have an excess policy through a business, or if they have an umbrella policy through their home that might cover them. So you're going to want to check all of those avenues prior to agreeing to waive subrogation against that individual. As you get closer to resolving a claim, pursuing this matter through to a trial, there may be a consideration of bifurcating the trial for an underinsured claim. And that's if there's $100,000 or $250,000 of underlying coverage and you have only, some exposure above that and it's a somewhat minor injury, you may ask the court to bifurcate the matter so that the underlying claim against the tortfeasor can proceed. And if there is, in fact, a verdict that exceeds the policy limits, then there would be an additional trial on that issue, and where you would get the set off of the underlying policy. So if there's $100,000 that is awarded by a jury against the tortfeasor and there's only $50,000 of underlying coverage, you would then step in. That $50,000 would be paid by the tortfeasor. There would be another trial regarding the damages, and if they award $100,000 again, you would get a set off of the underlying jury verdict that was paid. Finally, this is an issue that is coming up recently, and that is the issue of adjuster depositions being requested for uninsured and underinsured claim adjusters by plaintiff's counsels. They have been arguing with some success in many jurisdictions that the claim adjuster on an uninsured or underinsured claim because it's a contract claim, they have a right to question the adjuster on a number of issues, including why they haven't waived subrogation, what did they think of the case, do they think there are any policy impediments to making a recovery, and most significantly, they're trying to find out what the value of the claim is from the perspective of the claim adjuster. Some of the ways to avoid some of these discussions or having some of these topics come up is, first of all, with regard to the issue of claim value, that is a determination that is a work product It's the mental impression of the claim adjuster. So that, generally speaking, will not be discoverable. There's also the issue of whether this is even relevant, what the claim adjuster values the claim at, or what the claim adjuster's opinion of the claim is. Generally speaking, for an uninsured or underinsured claim, it has to do with whether the insured has legal entitlement to payment. And that is something for a jury to decide. It is not something that the claim adjuster gets to decide on their own. In order to avoid having a significant amount of information that is discoverable, it may be beneficial to avoid reviewing some of the documents yourself, so that if someone is, you know, if you're getting summaries from defense counsel regarding medical records and depositions, rather than reviewing the information independently, reviewing the attorney's summaries will preclude that from being disclosed, because your opinion about the testimony and the medical records and all those things has been filtered through the attorney's counsel and guidance and the attorney-client privilege, and that's also work product. Whereas if you're reviewing these records independently, then those are mostly facts that are discoverable, and your opinion on them is less about the work product and more about an interpretation of those based on your experience. So just be aware of that. It's going to be an issue. Protective order should be filed in most cases when a claim comes in to help address this issue. Plaintiff attorneys are making a lot of attempts to have these depositions go forward, and judges have been ordering them to go forward, but with certain limitations on the scope of the discovery that can be had. Hopefully, if you are able, you know, your counsel is able to work well with the opposing counsel to avoid some of these depositions. Sometimes they're generally meant to harass or intimidate the claim adjuster into making a decision that the plaintiff finds favorable that they are unwilling to make outside of that deposition process. And putting them on the stand can help the plaintiff attorney make the claim adjuster feel some of that heat about the claim itself. Thank you very much for attending today's seminar. If you have any questions, my contact information is listed on the slide here, and I look forward to working with you on many of these claims.